Teaching that changes lives. 12 Mindset Tools for Igniting the Love of Learning. Written by Marilee Adams, PhD. Narrated by Anna Crowe. Forward. We have devoted many years as educators to writing and teaching about the habits of mind, dispositions needed for productive thinking and problem solving. Although many people refer to these dispositions as soft skills because their measurement does not yield hard data, we nonetheless believe that these are essential skills that students need in order to succeed in the increasingly complex, uncertain future that awaits them. Happily, we are part of a large and growing community of educational authors, thought leaders, and teachers who share this belief, and whose work is making a solid difference in many countries around the world. With Teaching That Changes Lives, Dr. Marilee Adams joins this constellation, contributing her insightful work on mindsets and questioning for the benefit and satisfaction of students and teachers alike. Through the rich traditions of teaching through storytelling, Dr. Adams demonstrates how our mindsets, the perceptions we hold of the world, impact our students, our colleagues, and ourselves. In this engaging educational story, Marilee has captured key emotional and intellectual challenges that teachers encounter in today's classrooms while weaving in practical, time-tested tools for meeting these challenges. The characters, drawn from real life, demonstrate how it is possible to literally change the weather in the classroom to gain optimal rapport, engagement, responsiveness, and learning. The concept so artfully presented here is how a teacher's mindset, cognitive processes, beliefs, and mental models affect their behaviors and their ability to connect with their students. Through the story, we become aware of how our external, observable human behaviors are a result of our inner thoughts, decisions, and perceptions. The author leads us to the practical consideration of how a teacher can manage his or her mindset even in challenging circumstances. Teaching That Changes Lives offers insights and tools to help teachers recognize and choose their own mindsets, building consciousness and skills for leading their classrooms and enhancing their students' learning. This mindset work holds real promise for contributing to the intellectual and emotional development of students. At the end of the audiobook, Dr. Adams has included a comprehensive workbook with 12 practical, easy-to-apply tools for thinking about our own thinking and gaining new awareness of options and interventions that are congruent with our intentions. This material is an invaluable contribution to the body of work available for professional development for educators. The implications of this work are not just for educators, however, but are for all of us to become more metacognitive in life, becoming more aware and skillful with our choices and decision-making processes, and more mindful of our actions and their effects on others, both in our schools and in our lives in general. Teaching That Changes Lives is a valuable contribution to our field, and it is an important reminder of the cognitive and collaborative skills required for encouraging more thoughtful students, classrooms, and schools, as well as for building the next generations of thoughtful leaders who believe in their power to change themselves and thereby change the world. Arthur L. Costa, EDD, Granite Bay, California. Bena Kallik, PhD, Westport, Connecticut. Co-authors, Learning and Leading with Habits of Mind, 16 Characteristics of Success. Co-founders, the International Institute for Habits of Mind. Introduction, Mindsets for Learning. The hidden curriculum is the teacher's own integrity and lived conviction. It is the message which is written in a teacher's eyes throughout the course of his or her career. It is the lesson which endures a lifetime. Jonathan Kozel. You wouldn't be listening to this audiobook today had it not been for the teacher who changed my life. As a youngster, I was never a star student, though I always had a book in hand, often reading at night with a flashlight under the covers or hiding in the closet to finish a story long after my parents thought I was asleep. While I loved to read, school was often a struggle for me, and I had little confidence in my own abilities. It was in graduate school that a single teacher, Dr. Bill Friedman, provided that magical combination of caring, connection, and intellectual conscientiousness, wherein I was able to flourish. While Bill was demanding, he was also kind and patient, always letting me know he believed I could live up to the high standards he set for me. Over the years, he helped me hone my natural curiosity into the kind of disciplined question asking that is the foundation of critical and creative thinking, and thereby contributed to the path that has become my life's work. Through Bill's tutelage, I made some of the most significant changes of my life, in my mindset and in the beliefs I held about myself as a learner, thinker, and as a person. The evidence for those changes showed up in sometimes unexpected ways. Once, when another professor deeply critiqued one of my papers, I surprised myself by easily responding, "Okay, what do I need to learn to fix it?" If, instead, my old mindset had been in charge, I would have drowned in a familiar downward spiral of self-reprisal. Of course, that would have prevented me from learning from that professor and going on eventually to turn in an excellent paper. Now I remember that incident fondly as my matriculation into mindset school, where we are all perennial students. Almost everyone agrees that the overarching purpose of education is to prepare students for the future, yet never before has the future been more difficult to predict or prepare for. To borrow Neil Postman's metaphor, students who enter school as question marks and leave as periods will certainly be ill-prepared to face the uncertainty of a future where there are no easy answers. Consequently, being a teacher today is more challenging and potentially more exciting than ever before. The key is helping students develop excellent thinking skills and the capacity to engage in vigorous problem-solving to tackle the novel situations that the future has yet to reveal. While it is essential that we teach the core skills of literacy, numeracy, and technology, students will need to be more curious and creative than ever before. They will need to be resilient and have effective skills for interacting and collaborating with others in positive and constructive ways. This is why our schools and classrooms must provide environments that encourage students to develop a lifelong love of learning. These proficiencies are so important to businesses and organizations that many emphasize continuous improvement, providing training focused on communication, decision-making, critical and creative thinking, building collaborative relationships, and general people skills. Teaching interpersonal communication and thinking competencies is of a different order than teaching the ABCs or math, where correct answers are more easily tested. Even when students get all the right answers on subject area tests, it is no guarantee of their preparedness to pass the tests of life. Most of us recognize that answers typically close thinking, while questions typically open it. Lest we forget, answers are only the end point of a process. They can be only as useful as the questions and thinking that precede them. In Learning and Leading with Habits of Mind, Drs. Arthur Costa and Bena Kallik write that we must be interested in not only how many answers students know, but also how students behave when they don't know an answer. We are interested in observing how students produce knowledge rather than how they merely reproduce it. A critical attribute of intelligent human beings is not only having information, but also knowing how to act on it. As fundamental as questions are for attaining knowledge and living our lives, it is easy to overlook the importance of the mindset from which a question is launched. One's mindset will have a huge impact on any answers or results that might follow. In the words of Stanford University researcher Carol S. Dweck, "When you enter a mindset, you enter a new world." She cites compelling evidence for the impact of mindset in multiple areas, especially in learning and intelligence, and discusses how mindset interventions can even help resolve conflicts between long-standing adversaries. Dr. Dweck's formidable research on the distinctions between what she calls the growth mindset and the fixed mindset is conceptually aligned with the learner and judger mindsets described in this audiobook and in my two previous books, The Art of the Question, A Guide to Short-Term Question-Centered Therapy, and Change Your Questions, Change Your Life, 10 Powerful Tools for Life and Work. An international bestseller, Change Your Questions was originally intended for a business and organizational audience, but has acquired a wide readership among educators. These books illustrate how skillful mindset management can be strengthened through developing greater facility with the quantity and quality of the questions we ask ourselves and others. Teaching that changes lives focuses first on the teacher's mindset and the impact of that mindset, learner or judger, on their students, and on their own satisfaction with the experience of teaching. As you listen, you'll also see how these same skills increase teachers' job satisfaction, which, according to reliable studies, has hit the lowest point in a quarter of a century. The skills outlined in this audiobook help us stay calm and present in order to think clearly and strategically from moment to moment, including when leading a classroom. These skills also help us successfully manage difficult situations that are a part of everyday life in many classrooms. The focus is on cultivating the learner mindset for professional development, enriching the climate of learning, whether it's with whole classrooms, individual students and colleagues, parents, or professional learning communities. In writing Teaching That Changes Lives, I chose to employ the same allegorical form as I used with Change Your Questions, Change Your Life. According to the Wikipedia, allegory is a device in which characters or events in a story, poem, or picture represent or symbolize ideas and concepts. Successful allegory takes us deeper into our own lives, empowering us with new thinking, skills, and possibilities. My readers often share how much they have personally benefited from the mixture of story and practical application that the allegorical form provides lessons embedded in a page-turner. The narrator of the story is Emma Shepherd, a sixth-grade teacher who is a composite of many people I have known and worked with. Hopefully, you'll find the story of Emma's struggles, insights, and breakthroughs to be engaging and enjoyable to hear, while keeping in mind that her character is a vehicle for illustrating the learner mindset system at the heart of this audiobook. Another main character is Dr. Sophie Goodwin, a university professor in a school of education. Dr. Goodwin's early work developing the mindset system of tools had a powerful impact on Emma when she had Sophie as her sixth grade teacher. The mindset and questioning lessons woven throughout Emma's story are rendered into 12 practical, easy-to-apply tools presented in a workbook at the end of the audiobook. Much of Emma's story takes place in her sixth-grade classroom. I had very specific goals in choosing this grade as the setting for the story. First and foremost, this age group constitutes an important milestone when students often develop their own intellectual interests and passions, sometimes independent of what they're being taught at school. Many educators and brain scientists believe that if we can deeply engage students in learning and thinking by sixth grade, we can not only keep them in school longer, but encourage their continuing intellectual, social, and emotional development. Almost everyone understands that we need to find better ways of accomplishing this end. Dropout statistics indicate that a quarter of American students drop out of high school before graduation. And in urban areas, those statistics are even more distressing. Perhaps it's not surprising that teacher job satisfaction has also declined significantly. As I've mentioned, many educators have already read Change Your Questions, Change Your Life. If you are one of them, you'll find that these two books complement one another. While the settings, characters, and stories are different, both books focus on the importance of mindsets, thinking, and questioning to achieve desired results. Teaching That Changes Lives illustrates how the mindset tools that have proven so successful for readers of Change Your Questions can make a similar positive difference in the world of education. When teachers strengthen their ability to manage their own mindsets skillfully and intentionally, they become more effective and satisfied as educators. When students strengthen their ability to manage their own mindsets skillfully and intentionally, they become more effective and satisfied as learners. Emma's story illustrates how she uses her newfound mindset skills to great benefit with her students and colleagues and for herself personally. It is my heartfelt desire that teaching that changes lives might contribute to each listener's greater fulfillment and success as a teacher, educational leader, parent, or student. I can think of no better way to pay homage to my own teachers and what they contributed to my life. You can imagine how gratifying it was for me to find Bill, the teacher who helped change my life so long ago, and let him know I've dedicated this book to him. Chapter 1. The Alchemy of Inquiry. Not just part of us becomes a teacher. It engages the whole self. Sylvia Ashton Warner. I leaned against the kitchen counter at our home on Cedar Avenue, gazing out the window into the backyard. Since it was during the Thanksgiving break at my school, our cherry tree was bare, the grass lifeless and brown. But inside, sunlight streamed through the stained glass artwork which hung in the kitchen window behind the sink, sending little rainbows of light all around the room. Tiny facets of color danced over my arms and apron. The real magic to me, however, glowed through the big question mark at the center of this artwork. Set in a simple wooden frame, a bit larger than a three-ring binder, that colorful stained glass image was a poignant reminder of Sophie Goodwin, who had been my teacher in the sixth grade, a year that dramatically changed my life. Much later, when I myself began teaching, Sophie became the most important mentor I could have ever wished for. At the bottom of the frame was a small silver plaque that Sophie had had inscribed years before. She said this quote had been a guiding principle throughout her life. "The important thing is to not stop questioning." Albert Einstein. Why that quote was so important to her was a mystery at first. As a child, I couldn't have begun to imagine the essential relationship between Einstein's words and what Sophie would teach me about questioning, mindsets, thinking, learning, and listening. What I did know for certain was that Sophie had a miraculous ability to create a safe, open, and inviting climate for learning. She connected with her students in ways that awakened our minds so that we became more engaged and successful learners. I had experienced something in Sophie's very being, that is, in who she was when she walked into the classroom, that changed how I thought about myself and how I felt and thought about the world. Many people said her abilities were a gift one is born with, the way some people say that a gifted artist or a musician's or scientist's gifts are innate and not something one can learn. However, Sophie would clearly show that her gift and her impact on students could be learned. After retiring from classroom teaching, she earned her doctorate, became a professor in a school of education, and began mentoring other teachers, teaching them the tools she had developed over her lifetime as an educator. Veteran teachers, those just entering the profession, administrators, and educational leaders were soon finding their way to her classes. As important as she'd been for me in the sixth grade, I had lost touch with Sophie until my second year of teaching, when I was facing a crisis in my profession and was on the verge of quitting. As a child, Sophie's influence changed how I thought about myself and my capacities as a student. Now, as an adult and a teacher, her wisdom helped me avoid what would have been one of the most disastrous decisions of my life. Only as an adult would I learn from her how to apply her wisdom and tools in an intentional and systematic way. And I believe I changed the person I am whenever I walk into a classroom. That's what this story is about. But more than that, this audiobook is my way of honoring Sophie's dream of making her innovative and practical teachings widely available and easily accessible to others. Sophie's work is not part of any formal curriculum you might run across, but I believe it is fundamental to helping teachers manage the incredible pressures they experience while also reaching their most gifted students, as well as those who are struggling. Today, thanks to Sophie's methods, I am able to be the teacher I've always dreamed of being, leaving the classroom at the end of each day satisfied that I've made a valuable contribution. This audiobook has been a labor of love as I relived my experiences as Sophie's student and recorded what she later taught me about teaching when she became my mentor. To give some background, right after my graduate training and eager to start teaching, I spent the whole summer job hunting, but jobs were scarce for new teachers. I was on the verge of giving up and applying for a job at a coffee shop when a friend suggested I look into Greenfield Elementary, a school in transition, thanks to budget cuts and certain problems they were experiencing. There had been school closings in the district, and several teachers had quit. The principal, Dr. Maelstrom, who'd been there for years, had recently taken early retirement. Class sizes had been increased and non-academic programs dropped. The school district was looking for teachers who would come in at the bottom of the scale with minimal benefits. It didn't sound great, but at least I would be teaching. I'd figure out how to make it work for me. On the plus side, the school had a new principal, Dr. Bob Marshall, who had already made a name for himself in education. I'd be co-teaching a combined 5th and 6th grade class with an experienced teacher's assistant, Mrs. Santiago. I accepted Greenfield's offer, and my husband Jared and I rented a small house just a few miles from the school. My first year at Greenfield went well enough thanks to my own idealistic exuberance and Mrs. Santiago, who had 4 years of experience managing the classroom under the teacher I'd replaced. She had also been studying nights and summers to get her teaching certificate. I liked Mrs. Santiago, but felt she was clinging too much to methods she'd learned from Mrs. Peterson, and it seemed like she resisted almost any change I wanted to make. This became a growing source of conflict between us. Like most schools in transition, morale had been low at Greenfield, though in the time he'd been there, Dr. Marshall had brought us a long way. He had secured additional funding, including a grant for a new computer lab, and we'd had a small increase in enrollment when a charter school merged their program with ours. Dr. Marshall's predecessor, Dr. Maelstrom, had left behind more than a few wounds and antiquated policies that some of the staff didn't want changed. Dr. Marshall definitely had his work cut out for him. In spite of the progress he'd made, there were some teachers, Ms. Privet chief among them, who were still fighting to retain the old principal's methods and considered Dr. Marshall too nice. He seemed to take this resistance in stride, winning over his adversaries one by one, patiently, confidently, and with great skill. His plan was to build a collaborative learning community at Greenfield, and he knew this couldn't happen by forcing people to immediately comply with new ideas and policies. Mrs. Santiago and I had a combined class of 34 students, many of whom required more individual help than we had time for. I worried about the underachievers, of course. But I also worried whether our more eager students, even those who earned excellent grades, were learning how to think. As for discipline, we were still limping along with Dr. Maelstrom's archaic point system that was posted on the bulletin board. The best kids got stars after their names. Those who misbehaved got big X's after their names and were threatened with calls to their parents, which most kids dreaded. Being a particularly regressive system, this chart was one of the few things Mrs. Santiago and I seemed to be in agreement on. We both wanted to change it. But there always seemed to be more pressing issues, so discussing it was put on hold. In spite of all that, our class was doing okay. Our achievement scores were acceptable, but this wasn't any great comfort to me. What bothered me most was what I was not delivering to our kids. By the middle of my second year of teaching, I was worn down by all my doubts, the burgeoning, distracting incidentals, and the extra duties I had to fulfill that had little to do with teaching. I felt overworked, stressed, and certainly underappreciated. I often recalled how excited and engaged I'd felt in Mrs. Goodwin's class and longed to be able to create that same experience with my own students. Why did so many of our students seem unenthusiastic and disengaged? What was I missing? Education had to be more than what Mrs. Santiago and I were providing. Was it the kids? Too much TV? Too many hours playing electronic games? Lack of parental guidance? A system gone awry? Regardless of the answers to those questions, I knew one thing for sure. What I experienced as a teacher fell far short of what I dreamed was possible. I had never been so discouraged and disillusioned. There were days when a job at a coffee shop began to look pretty good to me. One afternoon, Jared picked me up after school. We'd made a date to shop for a new sofa, our first major purchase together, if you didn't count the car we'd bought the year before. After that, we had planned to treat ourselves to dinner at our favorite restaurant. But I wasn't feeling enthusiastic about anything. It had been a particularly frustrating day at school, culminating in an argument with Mrs. Santiago over practically nothing. I'd ended up apologizing, but I was sure it was going to leave bad feelings. Jared and I pulled into the parking lot at the mall, and he shut off the engine of the car. Instead of getting out right away, he reached over and lightly rested his hand on my shoulder. "What's going on with you lately?" he asked. "You seem a million miles away." I wanted to lean over, lay my head on his shoulder, and have him assure me that everything was going to be okay. But I knew he couldn't fix what was wrong. I admit I can get a little edgy when I've reached my limits, and this was one of those days. I just wanted to go home, climb into bed, and pull the covers over my head. "I'm wondering why I ever got into teaching," I blurted out. "It isn't turning out the way I expected, not at all." Jared looked shocked and a bit irritated. "But that's been your dream for as long as I've known you," he said. "Can't you talk to a supervisor or something? Maybe your principal? There have to be other teachers who could help you." Truth be told, I desperately wanted to talk with other teachers, but it seemed like everyone had their own problems. And anyway, why would they care about me, a relative newcomer? If I told Dr. Marshall about my dissatisfactions, I was pretty sure he'd dismiss me on the spot, or at least start looking for someone to replace me. Sitting there in the car, I tried to tell Jared about what was bothering me, and he did his best to understand. I had a long list of grievances. Mostly, however, I had questions. Why did I feel so dissatisfied and down on myself about being a teacher? Why didn't I feel excited about teaching? Why didn't I feel more connected with my students? And why couldn't I make things work better with Mrs. Santiago? Most of the time, I just felt annoyed and resentful toward her. These thoughts and feelings plagued me even more than the escalating pressures of too much paperwork, too little time, and too little money in the budget for some of the things Mrs. Santiago and I wanted for the classroom. Not to mention the omnipresent awareness that both of us were technically on probation. Any day we could get the news that we wouldn't be hired back for the coming year. I had tried to remind myself to take it one day at a time, but that old adage was wearing thin. Jared and I sat and talked for a long time, and he did his best to be helpful. The only thing that came out of it was the decision to put off buying a new sofa. Taking on another big expense when I was so unsettled about my job didn't make sense. We canceled our dinner reservation and picked up a pizza on our way home. I felt terrible about spoiling the evening, but couldn't pretend any longer that everything was okay. My self-doubts gnawed at me more each day as I racked my brain for solutions. Maybe I just wasn't cut out for teaching after all. I couldn't go on the way things had been going. It finally came to a head late one Friday afternoon as I sat alone in my empty classroom. In the distance, I heard the whine of the janitor's vacuums and the shouts of children out on the playground. I stared off into space, feeling like the dark cloud hovering over my head would be there forever. Where was the excitement about learning I'd experienced as a young student? Mrs. Goodwin had worked her magic on all of us when we were kids, but it was painfully obvious I didn't have her gifts or her patience. I wasn't as good as she was, and never would be. What happened next certainly wasn't a plan on my part, but a reaction to the dissatisfaction and frustration I'd felt building up in me. As I was leaving school, I noticed that Dr. Marshall's door was open, and he was doing some paperwork. He looked up as I knocked lightly and apologized for disturbing him. He smiled and gestured to a chair across from his desk, inviting me to sit down. I knew I needed to say what I had to before I changed my mind or lost my courage. Once I got started, the words came out in a rush. I thought I should tell you that I'm seriously considering leaving teaching. I'll finish out the year, but if someone comes along to replace me, I'll step aside. As these words left my lips, I felt a big knot twisting in my stomach. Every Monday morning when I walk into school, I continued, focusing my eyes on a light-colored rectangle where a picture had once hung on the wall behind Dr. Marshall. I just feel hollow. I know it's because I'm not delivering what these kids deserve and what they need. Isn't that proof that this isn't where I belong? When I turned my attention back to Dr. Marshall's face, I was startled to discover that he was actually smiling, not unkindly, but as if he just had some brilliant insight. "Emma," he said, "this may sound crazy to you right now, but I believe your misgivings say something positive about you. I hear your concerns, and I've observed your teaching. I can tell how much you care about your students and about teaching. Believe me, I would never have renewed your contract if I hadn't been pretty sure of you." He paused, I guess to let his words sink in. Then he added, "Fortunately, I know someone who may be able to help you. I'm sure she'd be willing to speak with you if I ask her." He told me that some years ago, he'd been at a similar life impasse. He'd almost left education until he learned about the importance of mindsets and asking new questions that transformed what he thought was possible. He said that some kind of alchemy happens when we change the questions we ask ourselves. My face must have expressed bewilderment because he chuckled and added, "You'll find out what I mean soon enough." He didn't go into details, but tapped a few keys on his keyboard, then jotted something on the back of one of his own cards for me. "I'm sure you'll like this woman very much. Please speak with her before you make a decision. She's semi-retired, but teaches at the university and still mentors a few teachers. I'll give her a call and let her know you'll be contacting her. After you've met with her, let's get together and discuss your next steps." I took the card and nodded, wondering what I had gotten myself into. I thanked him, went out to the parking lot, and climbed into my car. I slumped behind the wheel and wondered if I had made a big mistake by talking with Dr. Marshall. Had he been nice to me, bolstering my morale, only because he didn't want to bother looking for another teacher? Would admitting my shortcomings hurt my record? No matter. What's done was done. I glanced down at his card, stared at his name for a second, and then turned the card over. This had to be a mistake. The name he'd written on the card was Dr. Sophie Goodwin. Could this be my Sophie Goodwin, my sixth grade teacher? That would be too much of a coincidence. Driving home that afternoon, I kept seeing Mrs. Goodwin's face in my mind's eye and remembering moments from her classroom. What a wonderful year that had been in my life. I'd been this plugging along kid before that, making do and just getting by. During her class, I came alive to the experience of thinking and learning, even enjoying working on projects with other students. Mrs. Goodwin had been the first person to plant ideas in my mind of going into teaching someday. Who am I kidding? She was practically the first person to recognize that I even existed. At least that was how it felt at the time. At home, I did a computer search for the university where Mrs. Goodwin taught, then clicked through to the faculty bios. My heart skipped a beat as Mrs. Goodwin's picture came up on my screen. Though she looked older than the idea of her in my mind, there was no mistaking that smile. It really was her. And she really had become Dr. Sophie Goodwin. I started to dash off an email to the address listed with her bio. Then I thought better of it and decided on a handwritten note. The next day, I bought a card with a beautiful nature scene and wrote her a message, including my email address and information about myself, such as when I'd been her student and how Dr. Marshall had suggested I meet with her. After mailing the card, I felt hopeful for the first time in weeks. If anyone could help me, it would be Mrs. Goodwin. It seemed like an eternity passed with no reply. Had Dr. Marshall told her something about me that put her off? I could hardly imagine Mrs. Goodwin not responding right away. Poor Jared had to listen to all my anxieties as I waited for her reply. Then one morning, an email from Mrs. Goodwin popped up on my screen. "I would love to meet with you," she said. She apologized for what she called her tardiness. Personal matters had come up. She didn't give any details. To my surprise, she suggested that we meet the following Saturday at her place, about an hour's drive from my home. We'd have tea and talk things over, she'd said.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.